Thank you all for joining this session. I'm happy with this turnout. So first of all, I want to ask you, why did you join this session? Does somebody want to share, you know, what you want to get out of this session? Yeah, okay. totally agree. Totally agree. Marketing, I think, thinks otherwise, but yeah. 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 Okay, cool. So, first of all, before I start, I want to share this quote with you from Satya Nadella. For those who don't know or missed it, Satya Nadella is our CEO. And Satya Nadella said, you know, judge us by the things we did in the recent past, current day, and the future. And I think if you want to take away one message today, this might be it. You know, you might be skeptical about, you know, Microsoft doing open source. I know I was when I saw the Microsoft loves Linux statement a few years ago. But yeah, at least consider us. You know, I hope to invite you, if you're not familiar with the work we're doing at this moment, to at least check it out. Try our services, you know, consider us. Okay, so a little bit about me. My job title is really great and corporate, so I'm a partner technology strategist. Well, that doesn't say anything. Well, it comes down to I work with partners. Microsoft really invests in a partner ecosystem, you know, because doing everything as a Microsoft, we are big right now, but we would, you know, maybe quadruple the size or something to help everybody. So we really rely on our partner ecosystem for anything we do, selling the services, you know, doing learning, everything is around the partner. Well, I'm a techie, so what I'm doing with my partners is just, you know, discussing with them which technology is there, what are they doing, what do the customers want, getting them into contact with our product teams. Know, because everybody, well, it's really the new Microsoft. Everybody you can just call or just send an email. So for me, it's very easy to, if a partner has a problem, to just connect them to each other. I focus on open source, on developer productivity, and on infrastructure. And, well, there I get a bit in limbo because, you know, serverless, is it infrastructure or... But yeah, it's a corporate thing. Originally, I'm a developer in Visual Basic. Was for a long time. And then Microsoft and me, well, we lost sight of each other. Yeah, unfortunately. Fortunately, I joined the open source world and worked for a long time for an ISP, for some consultancy companies here. I'm a Clippy fangirl, and besides Clippy fangirl, I really deeply care about diversity and inclusion. This is also a topic on which I, within Microsoft, but also at our partners, like to speak up about. Okay. So, I got a call about 18 months ago, it was Microsoft, and then this happened. I was like, what, Microsoft? Really? Why would I, you know? And then I dug in to what all the great things that were happening, and I was like, this is a train I want to jump on. I want to be there. This has changed. So, I hope to rub off a little of my enthusiasm on you guys. Trivia, there's a star there, don't make a picture. I have more Red Hat certifications than Microsoft certifications, and my manager doesn't like that as well because, well, I need to do some work there. So today, not about me. There's two things I'd like to do with you guys. It's first of all take you on the journey of open source in Microsoft, or Microsoft and open source. When I came up with this idea, I decided to just be very honest and open with you guys and start at the beginning of open source history there and our role and how we evolved. Then I'll just tour some Azure services you might like because it's the week of KubeCon and I chose Kubernetes, our Kubernetes service. So, yeah, before Clippy, because there was open source before Clippy actually was developed. So in the 60s, you know, it was the origin of open source software. You know, mostly academics, the user, you know, was also the programmer, and this is where it all started. But then, eventually, you know, there was were different choices for computing, right? So computing became more available. The academics became the programmers, not so much the users anymore. So those were two different persons. And then, eventually copyright happened, right? So there was this company. There are quite a few fans here. And they said, the operating system, it's licensed, it's closed, you have use rights. Then eventually this guy comes along, you might all know him, and he started GNU, the Free Software Foundation, and GPL, which is obviously a great thing, right? Considering the time we were in at that moment. And Microsoft, being a very old company, responded to this trend with a letter by our CEO at the time and founder, Bill Gates. And it was the open letter to hobbyists. And, it really came down to, it's nice you're doing this open source hobby, but please stop this because, you're not innovating. You don't have the funds to innovate. You can't invest in it. Skip to the 90s, the age of the Spice Girls, and also the World Wide Web. Both I like very much. And there was this guy, and he came up with the kernel, making GNU much more usable. Linux was born there. Also, at the end, the Apache web server was there. There were new open source languages being developed. In the 90s, eventually they said, free software is not, it's not helping to call it free software. The open source initiative was born. And this is, a big milestone. Clippy was introduced with Microsoft Office 97. Yeah. Awesome. Red Hat goes public. Yeah. Great investing from some large corporations. Bill Gates did some interesting things again. Said, we need to cooperate with other companies to keep the business going, but still denouncing open source a lot. Open source will eat your business is one of the quotes. We made an agreement with Samba. There was a grave period of all kinds of lawsuits. Between the different companies, and it was really a bit of a harsh time. The predecessor for AWS was born, Google was born, Oracle, bought Sun. That's happens. The first contributions, the company, saying, open source will eat your business. The first contributions for Node.js on Windows were done. And then, a new period starts. And this is where, you know, under the hood, all kinds of things were happening, right? We did release some stuff on SourceForge at the time. We did work and contribute to some projects, but it was all, well, you know, under the radar. And then came along the new CEO, this guy, Satya Nadella, and he said, well, Microsoft loves Linux. And this is, I think, an iconic picture which you all know, with Satya standing in front of a screen with, you know, big, bright letters, Microsoft Hard Linux. So, .NET Foundation, Windows Azure was rebranded to Microsoft Azure. At the time, we were really able to support Linux workloads. VS Code was conceived, Node.js Foundation, and then it really, you know, it got into stroomversnelling, slipstream, right? With announced SQL on Linux, can you even imagine? And WSL on Windows. And for those who's familiar with WSL, yeah, okay, it's a way to get a decent, you know, command prompt there. But we'll come to that. That was released. It's the Windows subsystem for Linux. You're able to have a somewhat integrated experience at this moment. Microsoft joins the Linux Foundation, Cloud Native Foundation. Well, AKS is conceived. This is our Kubernetes offering on Azure. Then 2018, last year, about 50% of the cores were actually used by Linux systems on Azure. So, you know, the workloads on Azure are really, you know, hitting the 50%, and why not 50 plus or at the time? Because, you know, workloads scale up and scale down, and, well, apparently enough to say, well, about 50%. Don't have the latest quotes on that, so I'll leave it there, but it's a year ago, so do the math. We released our first Linux kernel, and it's used on Azure Sphere, which is an IoT device meant for IoT use, that was pretty cool. Surface Fabric, one of the services on which, you know, the Office products you know and love, might love, are running on top of that. It's all open source, you can use that. Same for functions, our serverless event-driven platform, and ACS Engine, which is the platform running Azure Kubernetes Service, right? So you can all download that and run it on your own machines in your own data center, and it's all contributed and for you to build up on. Then, we skip ahead to a few weeks ago, we announced WSL 2, and this is the moment we actually are announcing we are shipping our second kernel, and this time it will be on Windows. So Windows 10 will actually also ship a Linux kernel. So that's quite awesome. Oh, yeah, and, well, we you know, donated thousands and thousands of patents to the anti-trolling patent organization. So that's billions of dollars just, you know, being donated. And to make sure that, you know, when the patent trolls come and target the open source, the Linux community, and, you know, they have really, really a big amount of patents which they can throw right back at them. So this is quite an important move. Well, WSL, I'm just going to go through this really fast, but it's more or less like a VM running inside of Windows, but not your traditional VM. There's much more work being done on integration. It's very lightweight, and therefore it boots very fast. People used to working with the current WSL version, well, they might like this a lot. Also, the integration, the write speed, it's much faster. Also, X4 comes into the game. It's a file system. This is a bit what it would look like. Yeah. So you have the kernel, you have user mode interacting, and it will just make sure it's a tight integration there. So, well, what does it do? Well, you can actually launch Windows binaries from your command prompt. That's great. It's really something I was looking forward to. Back to Microsoft. Not only externally we said, okay, we double down on this this open source thing. We are contributing. We are helping the community. We are, you know, working with the community. But also inside, and this is a big one, because all employees are challenged to open source their source code internally. So everybody within Microsoft, all the engineering teams can all look into each other's source code and build upon that. And this is day-to-day reality. It really doesn't matter where you come, but everywhere you see and you feel this new world inside of Microsoft. And it's really cool, because we have this experience. We are a very large company doing all kinds of DevOps-y things and having all the product teams and having this open source thought. We also release products, you know, and we use them ourselves as well. So if you walk through the Redmond offices, a random building, you'll see all our CI/CD stuff running there. So that's actually quite cool. Good, well, but that's okay. How do we look at the open source world? What are the pillars, you know, we work with? Well, there's three of them. So the first one is about innovation. And like I said earlier, inventions we do at Corp, we try to release them and open source them and give them back to the community to build upon, like ACS engine, like functions. You know, just go ahead and improve this stuff and work with us. Yeah? The other one, and it's fairly unknown, and this is about all the contributions we are doing, working with the communities. So we have a lot of engineers spending time working on non-Microsoft open source projects, and that's all cool. The third one, it's more about enablement. I'll come to that later. So, that's a good story, but did you know? VS Code is open source. It's one of the most popular editors for developers in any given language. At this moment, who uses VS Code? What? Yeah? Cool. Well, okay, can I add a second thing I want you to take away today? Look at it. Sorry?
We always thought it was about Vim and Emacs, but maybe we're wrong.
I notice I'm just doing, you know, Vim, and I'm like, yeah, why am I doing this? It's a habit. But yeah, I come from the same. So, but check it out. Check. Well, it depends on what you're used, of course, and if you have any current machine. Yeah. Okay. So, actually, with the work being done on the new WSL, you could actually run VS Code on Linux and only having the graphical interface on your Windows kernel. So R, TypeScript, PowerShell, you know, those are languages with their origins also linked to Microsoft. And, well, we are a top contributor to the Linux kernel. And that's a big change if you look at that a few years ago. Who would have thought? Well, I told you about employees working at non-Microsoft open source projects. Well, we have about 5,000 employees doing about 2 million public commits. But there's also 8,000 non-Microsoft open source projects we work on. So that's huge. And the way we take upon this, and I think this is very good to take into account as well, is that our goal is not to just take open source and just make a huge, you know, code commit back and say, well, guys, throw it over the fence. Here it is. Good luck. We try to really work together and not, you know, create something, throw it over the fence, and people are like, what do I have to do with this? So we try to work together. I think this is the key message on this part, yeah.
How many external people work on code that is used by Microsoft?
Well, a good example, and that's a great question, good example is the .NET community. So .NET is open source. There's 19,000 developers from about 3,000-4,000 companies doing commits on .NET and related projects. So this is a huge interaction on a lot of things. You also see these products used at a lot of different places. So this is cool. Okay, enablement. Well, you know, having some great technology like Kubernetes, it's all fun, but then, you know, we are still a company and we try really hard to make it accessible for everybody, this technology. You know, it must be easy to use, easy to deploy, and if you want to run it in an enterprise, well, needless to say, we have some, you know, experience with enterprises. So we try to make it secure. We try to make it ready to deploy within the enterprise, so you can manage it, right? So this is what we try to do on top of this stuff, and it's good to take into account if we take Kubernetes and build AKS on top of that. We try to keep Kubernetes. We try to keep RHEL. Right, because if you want to use it, you want to standardize, right? So this is something we take into account. That being said, you have to run it cloud scale, hyperscale. So your attack surface is different, your networking might be different, all kinds of things might be different. We try to improve those things, but without, you know, touching the base too much, the product. We do also work with partners. One of our partners is Red Hat. We announced OpenShift a while ago, a managed service. What we try to do, if we release something like that, we work with them. So we have a space for them in our Redmond campus. We do the support together, and it all should be a seamless experience. We think that's very important. So that's a cool story. So who came in here and thought, okay, but, you know, is Microsoft, you know, is Azure really fit to run Linux workloads? Who's having doubts about that? Okay. Whoever worked with Azure? Okay. Yeah. So I think it's best, you know, I could put in some marketing slides about how great our stuff is. I'll just walk with you through a few things. And I'll elaborate on some stuff, so I'll just do a demo. Okay, so what I'm going to do is what I'm going to do is I'm going to deploy something very simple. I'm going to use Kubernetes. I'm going to deploy an API and some Mongo database, and I'm using a front-end, going to use a front-end as well. So let me just see if I can switch it without breaking stuff. Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, cool. Oh yeah, there's VS Code, which has this terminal, and well, we recently announced this terminal as well, and I thought I need a terminal. I have VS Code, and I'm always, you know, working in there because I can, you know, just edit documents and go about. Well, this might take a little while because it will prep my environment. Okay, well, that's cool. Nah, this is quite, you know, obviously if you're doing demos, you should always try to run preview functions. And, you know, if preview functions aren't exciting enough, you should always use the daily build of stuff. You know, it's best practice to demo with that. So, I'm going to walk through this. Luckily, a lot of this has been prepped. So let me clear my screen and take you on this deployment. So within Azure, you would deploy everything under your subscription in a tenant, and then your stuff would go in a resource group. Resource group, easy to remember, right? So then I would create an AKS cluster. Well, AKS, why would you want to use AKS? Does everybody know what our managed Kubernetes service is? Exactly, what is, okay. So So normally, you know, if you would run your AKS cluster, I'm not going to bother you much with that. You know what you've got to do. You've got to do all this stuff, deploying your management environment for your Kubernetes cluster, right? And you won't deploy it. You will also, you want to make sure it is scalable. You must make sure you can patch it. You must take all these things into account. Well, managed Kubernetes, well, what do we manage? We manage the entire control plane. You don't pay for it. It runs on our hardware. We will make sure it will scale. Yeah, we will make sure you can patch it. We'll make sure, you know, if it's broken, like some issue I had yesterday when prepping this demo, you can just, you know, reach out to them and ask them to fix stuff. So luckily that happens. So you get all these features, and on top of that, of course, integration with Azure. Well, after I deploy the AKS cluster, I will use ACR. It's our container registry, but then on Azure scale. So with ACR, our container registry, you would be able to scale it indefinitely around the world. It will be available anywhere, depending on the plans you choose, but it's geo-replicated. So there's also some tasks in there, so you can just interact with ACR, you can build your container, you can push it, and do other kinds of stuff with that. You don't have to leave your command line to test things out, right? So, let me switch back. Well, we'll create the ACR, get the credentials. because otherwise I will be probably in a place I don't want to be. There you go. So, you know, if you talk about security, you also want your ACR to be secure. So I will have to assign with my service principal ID. I will have to be able to be authenticated there. So who knows Helm? Really? Okay, there's a lot of things you can check out. In the end of the deck, you, I think will be shared with you. You can find links. There's also one in there on Helm. Helm is our packager. It's a bit of, I don't know, it's getting a sort of standard, I guess. Helm 3 is now recently announced. You don't have to, you know, you can just make packages, and you can also share them. So it's a repository for packages. You can just get packages to deploy Mongo in your container. You don't have to do, you know, 10 different YAML files and edit them and just package it and deploy it. So there's also some other projects we have. So like we have Draft Brigade and Virtual Kubelet, also stuff we maintain. Okay. So well, and this is why I just like the Visual Studio Code. I can, you know, have my editor here. What I will do is I will deploy this API. Well, obviously from Docker Hub. I will pass on some key value pairs to make it be able to use our application insights, which is an Azure service you can use to collect logging, but also, you know, use AI and a query language to make dashboards or to scale. So I will apply this, which is running because, well, I deployed it before. So then, obviously, I would want to be able to have a load balancer in front of this. No exciting things there. I would want an IP address. Good. So what I'm going to do now is to check if my API is working. I'm going to post some stuff there. It's my fictitious order application. Good. Then we would need a front end. Well, the same story. Obviously, we will use this Docker Hub. And we will need the IP address here, which should be the same. Yeah, good. So let's apply that. That's running for quite a while. We would need the service for that as well. And normally, you know, I would not choose to just use a load balancer. I would say I would use Ingress or something, or HTTP. But it doesn't work with the version I'm using at this moment. So, you know, if you use Bleeding Edge latest and greatest, there's a combination of services which might not be working yet. So working out the kinks. Luckily, you can just go to GitHub and just find out what's going on and interact with the product team, of course. So, good. Now, let's see if it's there. Yep, good. Now, what I will do is I will start a load test to make sure it breaks. Or at least I really hope it will. So, like I said, you know, you can just use the services you might be used to, right? You want to use your public service or your internal load balancer. You know, you'll just change your YAML file a little bit. You can use Ingress, of course. Well, it is a best practice to use a web application firewall. But a new thing we have, this is in preview right now, it's actually a combination of Ingress and the application gateway we normally provide. So we're looking, you know, to integrate that so we can go and communicate in two ways. We can communicate through the ARM templates. So for those not familiar with Azure, it's the Azure Resource Manager, and it's an engine you can use templates, and those are called ARM templates to interact directly with our fabric. So you can communicate either, you know, through the normal way or through the ARM template with a controller specifically made for this. So this is quite a cool new feature being worked on. Okay, well, this is great. It's started. So let's open the log files. Let's see. Well, this is good. So let me just log into the portal. And this is the thing we use this portal for two things, for demos or to have a graphical representation of for instance, application insights. It's a bit slow because it first goes to Redmond and then... Okay. Good. So let's take a look at our service. And while we wait, we could look at the pods. Well, there's two pods. I think they will be hammered a little bit. So what it does, it will, you know, start with 100 users and grow this exponentially to the point that eventually our pods won't be able to serve any requests anymore. And I like to do this a lot. And my manager likes it because the bill will be... You know, if I forget to turn this off, it will be huge. Okay, so let me check where it is. Yep, this is it. Let's go to the inside. So the only thing I had to do was provide the key. And I enabled the role-based access control rules to access the logging of this service. So probably it will start to... It will be hammered a little bit. Let me see if we can see it already. Oh, there. Well, this is not really a happy API. It's going through colors we don't want to see. We only want to see green. So there's still two pots. So what can we do? Well, we can do different things now. So we could scale this manually. We could use the autoscaler. Well, you might be familiar with that concept. I'll just delete this one. Whoop. So what I'm going to do is enable the horizontal autoscaler, so the pods will be scaled properly. I'm using some bogus settings, obviously. You don't want to scale it at this percentage, right? Okay, let's start the load test again. Always nice when it's a live demo, semi-live. Bear with me. So when it is done, it should scale this up. But then again, you know, while we wait, you can scale in a few different ways, right? You can choose the autoscaler, so your pods will be scaled. You could scale nodes, actually. But then again, if you scale a node, it will take a lot of time for it to come back up again. So there's two things at this moment which you can use, which are quite fast and cheap and easily scale down as well. One of them is the virtual kubelet. We call it virtual nodes if you look it up on Azure or on our website. So what it will do is it will create ACI containers, where ACI is like this. It's like our serverless container platform. So you can just spin up a container, just like I did with the load test. It just runs in an isolated container there, and it will scale very, 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 very rapidly, but also scale down very rapidly, and it doesn't cost as much. So if I leave that performance test on with container instances, won't cost me that much because it's a lot cheaper. Okay, so that's a good thing. So I don't have to manage the nodes anymore. I don't have to scale it. I can just use the virtual kubelet plugin. It will run inside my AKS cluster. So If I want to scale there, I would just be able to scale out to ACI as well without a lot of work. So let me see if it's done good. So it will take a while to scale. But that's okay. So while we wait, we can also look at the next thing. It's developer productivity. So just very quick, we'll skip to Azure DevOps. Who has heard of Azure DevOps? Besides the name, obviously. Okay. Well, Azure DevOps is our CI/CD solution and a lot more. So it has a lot of functionality in there. I'll just quickly show it because that's much easier. So for the example I just showed you, we have this repository. I cloned it. Yeah, it's here. So I have my code. I've put in a separate one for my environment, so for my Kubernetes. And I created some pipeline, very, very simple. Because you know, this is not your great big application, but it does a build, you know, and pushes it there. So if I'd be, you know, changing something in my code, it would be, you know, the entire CI/CD experience, and eventually it would deploy it inside my AKS cluster. So what we have seen is that we can, you know, use the tooling Microsoft provides, but obviously there's also a lot of integration with, for instance, Jenkins, but also Terraform. Those are all the products we really invest in. You know, we found out that a lot of Linux workloads, actually the people deploying it, use Terraform. So we said, oh, well, that's interesting. Let's just make sure it will be well supported. Same for Jenkins, and so on and so on. So this is the way we look at this and at developer productivity. So we want you to be able to run your workloads on Azure, and of course in your hybrid cloud situation, or on if you just download and build it and deploy it on your own environment. Good. So this concludes my talk. Are there any questions? I don't know if there's time for a few.
One or two.
Okay, good. That's good. Yeah.
Can you see in the future what Microsoft will do with Linux?
No, I can't see in the future. But you know, I think you know, if you're going to talk about the future, you know, most of the time you are wrong. Except, you know, you have this you don't have a glass ball there. But well, we already have one, because, you know, we already ship it with Windows. But maybe, yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'm, you know, those are really interesting times. And these are, you know, and this is one of the reasons I joined Microsoft. There's two things. One, it's the vision about, you know, what our future might be and how technology might play a role in it. And the other one is just because there's cool stuff happening there. The collaboration with community and the changes, you know, with Windows, with Linux, with our own kernel. I wouldn't be surprised about anything, actually. So, yeah. When I look at the future, though, and at cloud, I really see a trend moving towards more serverless. So we have a few offerings on that, but I thought, well, that would be, you know, a huge gap between you guys and what's happening there in that space. But I see a lot of stuff going there, and you know, recently in functions we started supporting PowerShell. So I was sitting with the product team, and I was like, okay, but why don't we support Bash? Well. Me, you know, not being aware of Microsoft for a few years, I was like, what? Because they said, well, we supported it a few years back, but yeah, well, you know, we stopped it because, well, it, you know, there's nothing to interpret, so yeah, why would we? And I was like, well, I know a big audience who would like that, so I've asked them, but yeah. So, you know, GitHub, spam the functions team on Twitter. Or something. Okay.
Last tiny question here.
What does loving Linux mean for Microsoft's business model?
What does loving Linux means for Microsoft business model? I'll try to answer that, but it's really about embracing open source, embracing the community, and working with them to create eventually products which we can use, you know, for enterprise, which we can use on hyperscale. You know, there's a lot of stuff being out there. We use it, we implement it, There's a lot of open source in Azure, on Azure, and we tend to use the stuff until it breaks, right? And when it breaks, it's really interesting because then we can find out together with the community what's happening, or with our own engineers, or you know. But this is it's about collaboration, and it's within Microsoft. It's not that different than Microsoft versus or with the community. It's really all about networking and you know having this challenge together. Does that answer your question?
Great. Thank you. It's great to see Microsoft going into the open source space. And thank you for that insight.
Well, thank you for having me. Thank you, guys.